Yo, Pierre, you wanna come out here?
The beginning of 2016, I was about 3 months in with my job with Epic Records, engineering for them.
It is a star.
Talked to my mom about it, but she was just saying, treat this opportunity as if it's a unborn child. Just give it time. We were 3 months in, so I was like, yeah, I'm doing a year. That's it. Like, that's it. 12 months and I'm out. 12 to 6, 8 to 2, every day except Sunday. Sit in there, record a writer or songwriter that's writing pop songs, or a rapper that's trying to do reference songs for Epic. It's a pretty different experience compared to now, where most people make songs for themselves. But it was cool to see and learn and understand the process of song making and songwriting and the science behind it too.
Said,
fuck
yeah.
Hey man, I'm here with my guy, motherfucking Pierre Bourne, you understand what I'm saying? We born to win, you understand?
Saucy.
Soul sauce, boy.
What kind of sauce y'all got?
I was hanging with Strick a lot when he was doing music with me. I was engineering for him a lot and making beats for him. He introduced me to TM88 and Aaron Reed. We went to a studio session. I was just tagging along. So I was pretty engaged, just talking to everyone, pretty much in everyone's face, just trying to work, just trying to get to know the industry. Cause that was my first time around some people that knew the industry. I'm not gonna be a dumbass and not try to rub shoulders, because that's what I moved to Atlanta for, to make it. By the end of that day, everybody was like, dang, I mess with Pierre, he cool. And we just exchanged contact information, and I told Aaron Reed, like, hey, my phone's broken. Just follow me on Instagram. Just hit me on there and I'll call you tomorrow when I get a new phone. Mind you, I maybe had like $300. Well, I'm capping. I definitely had like $600 because I was trying to move into a new spot. I got an iPhone and then I hit Aaron so it could be a blue message. And I didn't even immediately go to the studio after that. I kind of just stayed in contact, like every week, just hit him once or twice. When he FaceTimed me and saw me working, he told me like, when you get done or whatever, let's lock in or something. And I was just like, word.
We gonna fuck around and run it up.
Roll dab, roll dab, roll dab.
When I pulled up to the studio, finally, they needed an engineer that day, but nobody was sitting in the chair in front of the computer. And I was just like, I can engineer. And they were like, go ahead, P, let's see what you got. Me and Young Nudie met sometime in 2015. I was engineering at this studio on the east side of Atlanta, and his manager, $1, booked a studio session. They worked there all the time. I was the new guy. I didn't know what to expect. I just wanted to make some money. When they came in, I just looked at it as another session. I just didn't want to mess up. When I started recording Nudie, he was really dope. Like, really talented. And I was like, wow, I should have played him some of my beats. I wasn't like down about it, cause I was confident that we would continue working if I do a good job engineering. And that's what happened.
I got another country.
real hard. Like, that my boy, like, shout out, he engineer, produce, make beats, everything. I don't do the whole thing, you feel me? He like goddamn, he my whole everything in one, you feel me? He going to the top with me. Point blank, period. I don't give a fuck with nobody talking about.
The other people that's living in the studio, like, we all become like a family. It was this one guy named Joe, but he spells his name like J-O-W. He's crazy.
It's a war.
He's very, very, very talented. Plays the guitar, he can sing. He was in a similar situation as me. I didn't have shit. Nobody was looking out for me. I was homeless, basically. Like, I understood him, whether he knew that or not. So it was kind of hard to like continue working, and then you see somebody in that shape, but it also like kept me going.
J-O-W-B-N. The streets won't let me live, God won't let me die, for so, you know what I'm saying, man. But you know what?
Give him one time.
Oh!
Oh my God, that boy crazy. I love Joe, man. Joe definitely looked out for me, looked out for him. When we was in that studio, some hard times, man. We was hungry. Like, really hungry.
Oh, shit. Hey, how I make it play back on iTunes?
They're clueless to me. Mm-hmm. Nigga, I ain't an engineer. I don't consider myself an engineer. I don't.
Being in any place for a long period of time where you can't leave, you will become frustrated. You will feel stuck. You will feel complacent. Like, that's the laws of nature. But I understood why I was in that mind state, because I put myself in the studio for this opportunity and for something hopefully good coming out of the situation. So that's why I did that. I wasn't mad at myself for doing it. I already told myself I'm only doing this for a year. It was more so like prison, if anything. Well, this is my sentence, this is my bid. I didn't have no life, no love life, no regular life. I rarely left the studio. And if I did, I walked outside. I can really count on my hands like how many times I left and really did something. That really intensified the frustration, knowing that I can do something outside, knowing that I can be great. They tried to get me to L.A. Reid. Some people wasn't trying to let me leave as an engineer. When I first played my music for Chubby Baby, he was like, "You're like the rapping Metro Boomin." And I was just like, what? Like, what? Like, I was kind of mad when he said it, but then I thought about it. I'm like, oh, no, that's hard. Like, that's hard. And then nothing happened after that. But I knew they knew my music was fire. They just didn't want me to be fire, because they wanted me to make everybody else's music fire. Eventually, the Sundays became my day, just my day in the room. I really got to work on my own stuff on Sundays. I really look forward to those days, or whenever anybody would leave the studio so I could just turn on my music and just record. I was going through so much stuff, so that was like really the only way I could feel better, if I just do a song before I go to sleep. I knew I was gonna quit in a year. I was kinda at my wit's end. I dropped The Life of Pier 1 on my birthday, September 19th, and I think I quit like November. What made me make my decision was just a lot of like letdowns prior to that, like in those couple months, like my birthday, then October, like we did A3C, and that was trash. Like, it was just a bad experience, like with the people that are supposed to be my resources. I was just tired of people not hearing my stuff, and I keep working on all these other people's things. I was just like, I want to put my own stuff out now. Like, it's just sitting on the computer. And then Epic was relocating to another studio. They were setting a lot of rules. I can't have these extra sessions. So basically, my life it's going to be stripped away even more. And the day we were all packing up our stuff, I literally called my friends and was like, hey, I need you to pick me up. I think I want to leave. Like, my stomach's hurting. It's turning. I feel weird. Can you pick me up ASAP before they come back to call the Uber? And my friend pulled up. I dropped all my stuff in his car, and we dipped. And I didn't answer the phone for like 3 months. Like, I really had to just disappear. I had to really just ghost.
Now that I have this job where we gotta work on epic shit, that's priority. It's just, it's so much shit to do. It's like, sometimes I'll be surprised at myself, like, how the fuck am I doing all this shit?
Before I was in this studio, I was at another studio. Before I was in that studio, I was at the crib in my studio. And then before that studio, I was at my dad's house at my studio. Like, I've just always been in the studio. I'm ready for it. I'm tired of bouncing down songs. I want to do something else. These records can go. Because if it's dope enough, which it is, it's just going to go. And with that comes success. So after that, ain't no telling what's going to happen.
Before there was a Magnolia, but before I met Cardi, he been rapping. That's what the real fans say. Because that's the proof. The pudding is right there. Kanye put out The Life of Pablo. That's what made me do The Life of Pierre. This is my life, sleeping on this couch in this studio. I'ma start this series, but I know this series, it'll end when I'm on.
Aiden, yeah.